Great to be with you today in the Lord's house. Just a couple things to highlight that weren't in here or up on the screens, I don't believe. Pizza, the school's fundraiser with Unhinged. Those orders are due Friday. If you haven't had an opportunity to order some Unhinged pizza, someone will be at the back of church in the fellowship hall afterwards. You can order some of those. It's a great fundraiser. They make those on the 15th, I believe, so they'll be delivered or picked up that weekend as well. Youth, you are having Bible class today. Adults, we are having Bible class today. Children, you're having Sunday school today. It's a great day. Just a reminder that all those things are going on. This week and next week, I believe, are our last 2 weeks, and then we go on our summer break. Please come these last couple weeks. And then this past week on Wednesday, Aaron Wendorf received his call into the Holy Ministry at the service in Fort Wayne. He has been called to Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Osceola, Iowa, and Our Savior Lutheran Church in Leon, Iowa. So dual parish, please keep him and his family in your prayers as he finishes out his fourth year. And they move to, I think it's just south of, what's the big city in the middle of the state of Iowa? Des Moines, yeah, that's it, Des Moines, I don't know. Yeah, it's just south of Des Moines a little bit. So congratulations to him, God's blessings as he continues on his first call. It's the third Sunday of Easter. We do gather at the Lord's table today to partake of the blessings that he gives us there. Order of service is Divine Service Setting 3, and our first hymn is 839, O Christ, our true and only light, 839. Blessings to all of you this day. Confession and absolution, let us stand together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sins.
O O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner,
confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy innocent bitter sufferings and death, of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Continue as we sing responsibly the intro.
All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord. One generation shall commend your works to another, on the glorious splendor of your majesty, they shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness. The Lord is good to all. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord.
God, through the humiliation of your Son, you raised up the fallen world. Grant to your faithful people, rescued from the peril of everlasting death, perpetual gladness and eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Sunday of Easter is from Acts chapter 9. But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for the letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. And falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. Saul rose from the ground, and although his eyes were opened, he saw nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And for 3 days he was without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple at Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias." And he said, "Here I am, Lord." And the Lord said to him, "Rise and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas look for a man of Tarsus named Saul, for behold, he is praying. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints at Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who call on your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias departed and entered the house. And laying his hands on him, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road by which you came, has sent me to you so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight. Then he rose and was baptized, and taking food, he was strengthened. For some days he was with the disciples at Damascus, and immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." And all who heard him were amazed and said, "Is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon this name? And has he not come here for this purpose, to bring them bound before the chief priests?" But Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is from Revelation chapter 5. Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back sealed with 7 seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its 7 seals. And between the throne and the 4 living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing, as though it had been slain, with 7 horns and with 7 eyes, which are the 7 spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the 4 living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." Then I looked, And I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us stand together as we hear the Alleluia and rehear the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 21st chapter. After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, do you have any fish?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved, therefore, said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, but they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. When they got out on the land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have some breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" And they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go." This he said to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after saying this, he said to him, "Follow me." This is the gospel of the Lord. Confess our faith together using the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father. By whom all things were made, who for us stands.
seated. We continue with hymn 483. With high delight, let us unite. 483. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, it seems these days somehow, somewhere, everything is on video, right? Whenever something happens, it's either on someone's cell phone or they've got a surveillance video, a dashboard cam, a doorbell cam, body cams. Now, this can be put to good use, right? Many crimes are solved with using various of these options, but it can also be bad, right? Look at the movie stars, the politicians, where something's been caught on camera, it's played back over and over and over, and it gets seared into your mind what this person is all about. Good and evil, I suppose. But I got to thinking, it's not a new thing. I mean, oh, in one sense it is, right? The advancement that technology has brought us to this point. But in another way, it's nothing new. It's a tool that Satan has been using for a very long time. Because if you're like me, right, he keeps replaying the videos of your past sins in your mind over and over and over again. He doesn't want you to forget. No, he doesn't want you to forget all the mistakes that you've made, all the regrets, all the shortcomings, all the failures. Right, those things we've done wrong, the things we've failed to do, the things that if we could go back and do it again, we'd do differently. But we can't. I mean, even if we could, right? I have a sneaking suspicion we'd fail again in a new and more spectacular way, right? Satan has all the evidence he needs about how we failed. How we failed in our callings, in our vocations. And he loves to keep replaying it over and over and over again.
things that other people know, things that no one else knows, little things, big things. See, he says, look at this, remember this? Yeah, let's go to the video. So I'm thinking, if that's what it's like for you and me, it was probably like that for the disciples as well. Jesus had risen from the dead. He had appeared to the 11. They saw him. They saw his hands and his side. He ate with them. It was no ghost. Jesus had really risen from the dead. They should have been happy, and they were, but what about the video that kept playing in their minds? Peter. Peter's video, no doubt, of his denials. Oh, how he wished he could go back and do that again. Or Thomas, right? Thomas is doubting. What kind of disciple was that? Nathanael, remember back when Jesus called him, what he said? Nazareth? Can anything good come out of Nazareth? And then there's James and John, right? The ones who wanted the two seats of honor at Jesus' right and left. Did they really have the nerve to ask for that? And though we're not told who the other disciples were who were with them that day that we heard in our gospel reading today, I'm sure they had their own regrets, right? Past things that were on the video in their mind playing over and over. So what's Peter say, right? Hey, let's go fishing. Maybe that would get his mind off of these things. Right? And the others, yeah, and we'll go with you. But that night they caught nothing. Right? Failures as disciples, failures as fishermen. But just as Jesus had come to them 3 years before, so he comes to them again. And he provides for them again. And this story of him doing so is what we heard today. It's full of reminders. It's full of videos from the past. First was the day Jesus had called them to be fishers of men. Right? Remember, they'd been out fishing that night too. And like this night, they'd caught nothing. And then Jesus said, let your nets down on the other side of the boat. Or just like this morning, the fish came in. Right? It was like an instant replay. Then when Peter gets to the shore, there's this charcoal fire going. Imagine the sense of smell, right? Isn't your sense of smell one of the greatest triggers of memories in the past? Imagine that smell for Peter, who'd been warming himself around the courtyard of the high priest not so many days ago, denying Jesus not once, not twice, but three times, smelling that charcoal fire as he comes onto the shore and sees Jesus. Was that video flashbacking in his mind? And then Jesus feeds them, we're told, right? Bread and fish. He'd done that too, right? He fed the 5,000 and then the 4,000. It's almost as if nothing had changed, yet everything had changed. They hadn't changed. They were still sinners. Those memories were alive and well. And in a sense, Jesus hadn't changed. I mean, he was still doing the things he'd done before. Yet, he had changed. He had changed. He had died and had risen from the dead. But he was still here with them. He still loved them, wanted them, still had compassion for them, forgave them. And though they might not know what to do, he did. And they needed to learn. It was not their faithfulness. It was not their obedience. It was not their success. It was not their dedication that makes the difference. But Jesus, he did it. He did it for them, and he still would forgive them, raise them, use them. Just like it was the story of the other apostle we heard about this morning, Saul. Right? The story of his conversion, how Jesus came to him when he was on his way to arrest and persecute more Christians. But as Jesus let him know, when you persecute them, you're really persecuting me, right? Because they're mine, members of my body. So what you do to them, you do to me. And so Saul was struck blind. Could see nothing, could do nothing. They lead him into the city of Damascus, where for 3 days he sits in the darkness praying. For 3 days he sits in the darkness with, I'm sure, those videos in his mind replaying over and over all the things he had done, all the persecution, all the evil, all the faces of those people he had arrested and hauled off to jail. What do you think he was praying for? In a moment of time, he had gone from Saul, the strong leader, to Saul, the weak and helpless. From Saul, the zealot, to Saul, the fearful. From Saul, the successful, to Saul, the one who needed mercy. And mercy is exactly what Jesus had come to give him. Saul could do nothing, but Jesus had come to give him everything. And so he sends Ananias to preach to him, baptize him, forgive him his sins, give him the gift of the Holy Spirit, feed him. Jesus gives him and the others a new video now to play in their mind. Not of their sins and their failures and their regrets, no, but of his triumph and of his forgiveness. And you see, that's the video he has for you as well. We might not be able to stop Satan from replaying those horrible videos in our minds that show us just how sinful and unworthy and unqualified we are to be Christians. But every week, we come back to this place and hear and see something else. New images put into our minds that like the disciples, what we learn is it's not our faithfulness, it's not our obedience, it's not our success, it's not our dedication that makes the difference. It's Jesus. And that's the very image we're given today in that reading from Revelation. Who is worthy, the cry goes out. Who's worthy to open the seals? No one in heaven and on earth or under the earth was able. Imagine that. No one. Any place in all creation was worthy. Not one. And yeah, Satan's got the videos to prove it. But then look, behold the Lamb, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, the one who has conquered all. And there it is, the Lamb who had been slain. But it's not slain, it's not dead, lying on the ground or on the altar. No, it's standing, living. Bloody, yes. Pierced, yes, but living. And then the words, those beautiful words we sing in our liturgy. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb to be slain, to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. That's the video Satan doesn't want you to see, doesn't want you to hear, and so he'll try to keep you away from this place, to keep it out of your mind. And so he'll keep replaying your videos and reminding you, you're not worthy, you're not worthy. And he's right. But here is the one who is worthy. Worthy for you and here for you. To give you his mercy. To absolve you of your sins. To wash you clean. To raise you himself. To give you who are unholy his holiness. To give you who are unworthy his worthiness. To give you who are dead his life. That no matter what your past, no matter what your videos show, in him you have a glorious future. And so, like that day with the disciples, he invites us. He invites us, unworthy sinners, to be fed, to come to his supper, to be fed by him, to receive all of this, not by eating bread and fish, but his body and blood. Or as Paul, Saul, would later write, as often as you drink, eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Or, in other words, you replay the video of his death and resurrection for you. The video of his glorious victory for you. That's the video to see over and over and over again. The Lamb who was slain, who has now begun his reign, is merciful, compassionate, baptizing, absolving, feeding. Yeah, so while Satan may keep replaying the video of your sins over and over in your mind, that video has been erased in heaven. Those sins, those videos no longer exist in Christ. They've been erased with his blood and buried in his tomb. So Peter's denials, forgiven. Thomas's doubting, gone. Saul's persecution, what persecution? And your sins, separated from you as far as the east is from the west. You see, that's what Easter's all about. This glorious future, now and forever. You've been set free from the past, so now all those videos you have of others' sins against you, of their failures, of how you've let people down, revenged, plotted, given them a taste of their own medicine. It's time to erase all those videos, to forgive them and set them free. Or in old computer terms, right, to hit Control-Alt-Delete at the same time. That's the answer. To forgive and to be forgiven. To live without fear. That's the joy of Easter. That's the joy of our risen Savior for you and for all. The joy that enables us to proclaim that Christ is indeed risen from the dead. Amen. And now may the peace of God, that peace that surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in and through Christ Jesus your Lord. Amen. Let us stand together as we continue with the offertory, Create in Me. Thank you.
Let us stand together as we continue with the prayer of the church. Lord of life, we are sustained by the spiritual food you alone provide, and our lives depend on your powerful word. As you have gathered us here around the proclamation of your gospel, make us worthy to receive the bounty prepared for us in your Son's death and resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, enthroned in heaven, you have ordered all the nations of the earth and have set your church among them to shepherd them unto eternal life. Hear the prayers we continually offer for our rulers, as we continue to offer for those in the Ukraine. Lord, grant faithful and a peaceful reign throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate Lord, you are glorified in the sufferings of your faithful people. Teach us to trust you through our trials and graciously bear up those who struggle amongst us. We lift before you especially today Verona, B, Cutter, Ashley, Greg, Dwayne, Jim, Darren, Dale, Steve, Ray, Pete, Dick, Marlene, and Harlan. We pray that they would know the fullness of your love and in your time grant healing according to your will. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Heavenly Father, we remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you in your church and on earth, who now rest from their labors. We pray especially today for comfort to the family and friends of Eldonna Dorr and the family and friends of Wayne Rishmiller. Keep us in fellowship with all your saints and bring us at last to the joys of your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord God, mercifully and gracious Father, we give thanks for all the blessings that you have bestowed on Aaron Wendorf in his preparation for the holy ministry at Emmanuel Lutheran Church and Our Savior Lutheran Church in Osceola and Leon, Iowa. By your Holy Spirit, grant him grace in his first field of service, readiness and steadfastness in his ministry, patience, understanding, a cheerful spirit, and great zeal. Support and strengthen him and his family, that by your word, your church may be built and increased. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal Lord, you have prepared a feast again for us this morning of your Son's resurrection. Help us to rejoice greatly in this gift of his body and blood and to receive it to our eternal good, that we too would rise at the last day. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Continue with the preface as we prepare to come to the Lord's table this day. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. And most especially are we bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying he has destroyed death, and by his rising again he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and saying,
Thank you.
Our Father, who art in heaven, our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Together as we continue with the Nunc Dimittis, the songs.
Give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled to constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Seated for our closing hymn, 411, I want to walk as the child of the light. 411. 411.